to wrestling. Kennection.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to this week's edition of the Wrestling Connection. I am your host, as always, your connection to the wrestling world, Mr. Ken Hill. And alongside me, as always, is my good friend, the madman of wrestling himself, Mr. Zach Martinkus.
What, everybody, the champ is here. Recognize.
Something else we were forced to recognize this past Monday was the reformation of one of the biggest factions in wrestling history,
Evolution.
And that's where we're going. That's how we top off this week in review. This past Monday night, Triple H was at odds with the Shield after they turned on him and the Authority.
Yep.
You had Triple H trying to get them underfoot. You tried trying to get him to enlist Batista and Orton to help him. But Batista and Orton, they only cared about the WWE Championship. They could care less about Triple H. The Shield were Triple H's problem, not theirs. Even though Triple H said, if they were gutsy enough to go after Triple H, the COO of the company, they're going to have no compunction going after Batista and Orton, but they decided not to believe Triple H.
Shock and awe.
Shock and awe. And not some odd camaraderie, considering that they were both had selfish intentions for the WWE Championship.
Yeah, which is a surprise.
Later in the night, you had the Usos demanding a rematch with Batista and Orton after getting laid out last week. And things seemed to be, it was a back and forth match. But then suddenly, out of nowhere, here comes the Shield assaulting Orton and Batista, driving him away from the ring. And then you have him going backstage, and then you see Triple H stepping pretty much.
Saying we told you so. Honestly, what I think from that, though, that's basically, well, I would say, you know, payback is a, you know what, but in this case, though, to keep it rated, that's what I call the karma effect. Good things, better things. Bad things, worse things. In this case, prime example. So.
It was bad for Batista and Orton, it would get worse for the Shield later on the night. They were set to face a mystery team. We didn't know if it was just a regular team or if it was going to be like more than three people. That turned out to be the case, where the Shield were face down with an 11-on-3 tag team handicap match.
Yeah, which there's been a few cases where there's been handicap matches though, but this one
takes the cake.
Took the cake though.
You had the tag team Ryback, so you had Jack Swagger, you had 3MB. I mean, just to name a few people. And just after a while, even though the Shield started to turn the tide, the bigger group just said, okay, forget about it. They just assaulted the Shield, laid them out, and pretty much left the remains for the returning Evolution, for Triple H, Batista, and Orton, who are now one unified, focused group. Came down to the ring, picked the bones, left the Shield line, hitting them with all their signature movers with the pedigree, Batista bomb, RKO, essentially signifying that you don't need to believe in the Shield, you need to believe in Evolution.
Yeah, and that's
something I found kind of funny, considering they were in the Alabama that week, the proverbial Bible Belt.
Oh yeah, plus not to mention though too, I mean, as I predicted though, like this is basically, you know, the Shield going at war with Evolution. Not to mention, though, this is, I mean, you actually, Kenny and I mentioned this a little earlier, that this is basically, you know, the new generation versus, you know,
The old generation. Essentially, this generation's big faction versus yesteryear's big faction in Evolution.
Yep.
And the match has already been made at Extreme Rules. We're going to see these two factions collide. We're going to see the Shield, Roman Reigns, Dean Ambrose, Seth Rollins versus Evolution, Triple H, Batista, and Randy Orton.
Oh man, that's a match. It's going to be almost, just hearing the thought of this match. It's almost as epic, you know, back at the Elimination Chamber, where it was the Shield versus the Wyatt.
Because you had the two big factions of this generation.
Right.
Now you have one of those factions facing off with possibly one of the greatest factions in WWE history.
Mm-hmm.
And that's going to be a match to see. And it's going to be a matchup that we're going to discuss later down the line.
Oh, yeah.
Now, changing gears, we have the continuation of Bray Wyatt versus Cena. Cena coming out and kind of playing his own little mind games, more on the childish side, par for the course with Cena, sadly enough.
Yeah, which doesn't remind me too much of the what he did a few years ago with the Nexus, which for those who did watch that, you could tell there's some similarities between what he did with Nexus a few years ago and this case in particular.
Well, what he typically does, Cena usually uses infantile humor to kind of undermine his opponents.
Mm-hmm.
And the interesting thing is, unlike most, Bray Wyatt he pretty much summarized what Cena does in this case. You take a serious threat and all you do is make jokes.
Nice.
And that's kind of the problem I'm having here is that, okay, it's good that Cena's turning the mind games back on Bray.
But
he would keep the potty humor. He would keep the kitty humor out of it, okay?
Bring back the ruthless aggression part.
Bring back the ruthless aggression. I mean, essentially, get in Bray Wyatt's face,
mm-hmm.
more or less.
Right.
Like he did. I mean, he did that for the most part. Mm-hmm. But okay, just take away the childish humor. No kitty humor, no jokes, no happy-go-lucky John Cena. Just be serious throughout. Be consistent.
Right.
I don't have a problem with Cena being kid-friendly.
Mm-hmm.
I have a problem with him being inconsistent. Because you have one week where Cena's saying, okay, I admit it, I'm afraid of the Wyatt family.
And then
the next week, he's cracking jokes and being happy. He's saying, just give these dudes a couple of drinks. They'd be a riot in any nightclub.
Yeah, plus I was kind of horrified at the fact that we saw the picture of what really Sister Abigail looks like. I was horrified.
Of Sister Abigail. It's one of the times where I'm glad we don't have a picture to bring up here. It's not pretty.
Yeah.
All right. So now, changing gears once more. We had the tribute for we had a tribute last week for the Ultimate Warrior. WWE did a more thorough tribute for the Ultimate Warrior.
Yep.
And we saw several moments. One of those being Warrior's epic squash of the Honky Tonk Man.
Oh God.
For the Intercontinental Championship.
What was that in 30 seconds?
In 30 seconds at SummerSlam 1988.
Mm-hmm.
And the Intercontinental title is the Intercontinental, which is synonymous with guys like the Ultimate Warrior and the Honky Tonk Man,
mm-hmm.
was also the focal point on a few matches on WWE Raw.
Yep.
Because you had this Intercontinental Championship tournament to determine a new number one contender. And you had guys like Alberto Del Rio,
mm-hmm.
RVD,
mm-hmm.
Rob Van Dam, Jack Swagger, Sheamus, Cesaro, Mark Henry, just to name a few.
Mm-hmm.
And whoever comes on top in the tournament faces the champion Big E Langston at Extreme Rules for the Intercontinental Championship. Now, as we know right now, it's been narrowed down to four competitors.
Yep.
You have Cesaro.
Yep.
You have Sheamus.
RVD.
RVD and Wade. I've got some bad news for you, Mr. Bad News Wade Barrett.
I swear to I'm not even kidding. I would want to absolutely super kick him, just to shut him up or bury it. Actually, give my own version of the bull hammer.
Boom.
Pretty much.
you and me both. Mm-hmm. But it should be an interesting prospect to see who comes out on top here, because there are a great potential number of matches. We could see Cesaro versus Big E Langston, mm-hmm. two of the strongest guys in this generation of WWE's professional wrestlers.
Oh, no doubt.
I mean, that's something we'll highlight in the coming weeks going up to Extreme Rules.
Mm-hmm.
But now, ladies and gentlemen, it is time for Zach.
We want this. Boy.
It's time.
Okay, I swear to God, like, I'm sorry, folks. I was hoping I'd get something a little bit, you know, a little bit more creative from that, though, but... Next week. Oh, well. But,
You had someone very special that you wanted to call up this week.
Yeah, this... For most people that watch the show, though, usually I'm talking... I'm usually calling out a wrestler in particular because I have an issue with. This week, however, is a little different. This side of me, well, this time is actually a side that Kenny actually has seen over my over the years when I've done football. My basically my aggression side, or as I call it, the inner wolf, or as I dubbed it, the Lunar Wolf. And this side of me I've fought with over the years. I've had 4 fights in my life, 4 times that side's let out. Two have bled open. One I punched the broken ribs. The other one knocked them out big time. All right, choked out to the point when a guy almost had a seizure. They shall name anonymous. But, you have to understand, folks, this is a side of me that I've only let out a few times. And within those 4 times, it has almost wrecked me completely. And I'm sorry to... And contribute to. I wanted to. This is a side that I know you wanted to talk about something, but this is something I gotta do. Lunar Wolf. You may linger in me. You may try to control me. I know who I am, and I know who I want to be. You are not gonna let ever in my life control me again. Over my dead body, will you take control again? And those who do fear my wrath will get the claws. And because in the end, your fear is in my domain. Recognize and believe the hype.
Strong words from Mr. Martinkus. And I think that's something that all future prospective wrestlers need to understand. It's learning to lead. It's all well and good when you're wrestling in the ring, when you're playing a character on TV, when you're playing a character for the promotion you wrestle for.
Yeah.
But there is a huge difference between that personality and who you are outside of the ring.
Mm-hmm.
You have to learn to separate the two. You have to learn not to let them mingle. There are many wrestlers who have become the mask. There are many wrestlers who have become their personalities. And some are better for it.
It led to their destruction. One particular I am going to mention, as much as it's frowned upon for most people, is Chris Benoit. A guy who I have major respect for. In 2004 at WrestleMania 20. And the years of damage finally kicked into him.
3 years later.
Yeah, 3 years later. He did something unforgivable that no one... It's frowned upon for many people.
It's a prime example of following your dreams and perhaps following them too far, going too far. And following your dreams.
Mm-hmm. And the message I want to point out to everybody that has struggled with this inner demon in them, or this inner animal in them, as I have lived, endured, and survived hell on earth literally my entire life. And I still stand strong. This tattoo right here signifies my life, the code of the warrior. And it also signifies one other thing, is the balance between both those sides. Never let that inner animal come out. Keep that balance. And remember, your friends and your family are always there for you.
Now we go from that into someone who's, as far as wrestling goes, wrestling has been a part of his blood for years and years. Someone I plan on calling out in Ken's Den. Now, who I'm speaking of is, of course, the second generation superstar, part of the Brotherhood tag team, along with his elder brother Goldust, Cody Rhodes. Now, I've seen Mr. Rhodes' performance over the years. Former Intercontinental Champion, multiple-time tag team champion, respectable career, a very strong, solid career. But has the potential for so much more, and yet it just seems like that Cody has been stagnating in the tag team. I mean, you had a point where he was like the focal point, one of the biggest comebacks in professional wrestling when he and his brother Goldust defeated the Shield last year and got their job back. You thought it was going to lead to bigger and better things, and yet this past week they lost to Rybacksel in short order.
Well, I mean, it could have been a lot worse. It could have been like, you know, like how the breakups in the primetime players. I'm just saying though, like
The point is, Cody has the potential to be a world champion. Mm-hmm. We've seen the potential. We saw it when he first broke away from Legacy all those years ago.
Yeah.
When he started out as Dashing Cody Rhodes, then he became Undashing. Then he just became Cody, straight out Cody Rhodes, with an attitude. And there are points where we've seen that he has the potential, that he has potential to break out on his own as a superstar, and yet he's content with being in tag team after tag team. I'm saying, Cody, for crying out loud, you've got youth, you've got potential. The crowd loves you. The crowd loves your moves. They love your look. You have the look. You have the potential. You have the bloodline.
Yeah.
You have the Rhodes bloodline into you to be great, like your brother, and even more so, like your father, the American Dream, a former world champion, a former NWA champion, a former world heavyweight champion.
Sure.
Cody has potential to be all these things, and yet if he continues just to stagnate in the tag team division, he's never gonna go anywhere. He's never gonna amount to anything but just a solid, in Triple H's words, a B+ career.
Yeah, and plus, not to mention, he could lead down the same road like how his brother.
Essentially, it's true. I mean, if you think about it, the character changes, the fact that they're both former tag team and intercontinental champions, the fact that they've both been the butt of many a joke in their careers.
Dusty
summed it up a few years ago. He's raised some weird kids.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think Cody needs to break out of that weird shell and truly make a name for himself.
Right.
I'm not saying distance himself from his brother, from his father, but make a name for himself.
Exactly. Could have said it better myself, man.
Make Cody Rhodes a name that is synonymous with greatness, that is synonymous with world champion.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you're just going to end up just being another butt of the joke like Goldust, with all due respect. Now, earlier we were talking. Now, changing gears, we were talking about the Shield versus Evolution earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Shield being one of the biggest factions in wrestling today. The fact that they've been together for over a year.
I think at least two years.
For nearly 2 years.
Yeah.
And someone who has stood out in particular, in in recent months has been who the focus of our superstar profile for this week,
yep.
Roman Reigns. That was an earlier photo of Reigns during his time in NXT when he was known as Roman Leakey. He's part of the Samoan family along with Jimmy and Jay the Usos, their father Rikishi, the Wild Samoans Afa and Sika, even The Rock to a degree. He's the cousin of Rikishi. I mean, it's just a big family that spans generations. And Roman Reigns is the latest and possibly greatest example of the Samoan, how effective and how dominating the Samoan bloodline is.
Oh, yeah. I'm sorry, dude. I couldn't get over that picture. Just, I was like, is that a dude or a chick? Oh, my God.
You really thought that was a chick?
It really looked like him, man.
The hair looks. I mean, he's got the hair. He's got the beard and the muscle.
I thought it was just a chick without a blonde. Sorry, that's what it really was like. Oh God.
And we go from him calling out his ultimate personality to him giggling over a man in tights.
Oh come on! It's not like I come out of the closet. I'm just saying, though, for those who are asking. Yeah, shut up. Okay, anywho.
Roman Reigns has made a name for himself in WWE mm-hmm. over the last few months, had a spectacular performance at Survivor Series,
yep.
where it came down to him versus four opponents in a Survivor Series elimination match,
yep.
eliminating all four with his signature spear attack.
Mm-hmm.
The Royal Rumble pay-per-view this year, where he broke Kane's 13-year record by eliminating 12 participants in the Royal, more than a third of the entries.
Oh yeah, that's actually no. I've gone on before. It's like 40% though. It's like no one's done this. Like
no one's done it since Kane in 2001. Literally mm-hmm. 13 years.
Yeah.
And just he has established himself as the center of the Shield, as not just the powerhouse, but the center, the leader. He has and he made his impact even more a couple weeks ago when he speared Triple H, and he went on SmackDown later that week and said, "Triple H, my name is Roman Reigns, and I'm the man who speared you."
Yeah,
he is essentially putting himself out there.
Hey, but honestly, God, that we were like, thank you, God. I'm a little bummed out, though. He didn't get the triple power bomb, but Triple H, that will happen in one of these days. And I'm hoping to God, Extreme Rules, you will get speared.
That's what we're all hoping for. And I mean, if the rumors are true, I mean, Roman Reigns is supposed to be, he's very gifted. He's supposed to be potentially the next big superstar in WWE, the next John Cena, the next Randy Orton. He's got the bloodline. He's certainly got the physical traits.
Oh yeah.
He's got the crowd behind him. I think he has the potential to be one of the biggest superstars to come to WWE for the next few years.
Oh yeah, no doubt about it. So,
well, now time, ladies and gentlemen, it is now time for our WK Q&A segment, where we will bring on a...
Aren't we going to do one of them over?
Oh, that's right.
Yes. Yeah, we...
Actually, a little mix-up there. We are actually going to show one of Roman Reigns' signature maneuvers.
Time for Zack and Ken's Wall of Maneuvers.
And welcome to this week's segment of What a Maneuver. Our superstar profile highlight this week is Roman Reigns.
Mm-hmm.
And Roman Reigns, as you know, is a member of the popular faction known as the Shield in WWE.
Believe.
And,
believe in the Shield. Mm-hmm. And one of his signature maneuvers that he loves to perform, and it is one of a visually amazing move to pull off, is what is known as the Superman punch, which actually does take from the recent Superman films,
mm-hmm.
as we'll demonstrate.
And now, I'm gonna try. And this is a real dangerous move, so kids, this is real, real important. Do not try this at home. I mentioned this before. This is one of the times. Don't try this.
All right. So now, as you see, typically Roman will back up into a corner. He'll do the Superman pose, the three-point stance.
And then
he'll get a running start.
And like I said, kids, don't try this at home. This particular.
So now it is time for our WK Q&A question and answers segment,
mm-hmm.
where we will welcome a lucky viewer onto the show.
I swear to God, I'm like disorganized. Hey, what the heck?
And we'll answer a couple of his questions, sir. Would you like to state your name? State your name for the audience, viewing audience at home.
Yeah, my name's Stanley.
All right, and how old are you, Stanley?
21.
And what do you currently do right now?
Work at Wendy's.
Okay. Now, how long have you been a fan of professional wrestling?
Pretty much my entire life. Yeah, that's the thing. When people ask me, like, what age I started following pro wrestling, I don't really have an answer because I've watched it for so many years. And it's really, like, I don't know, like, I just can't give you a certain age. I've been watching it my entire life.
Well, if everyone wants to know the answer to this question, he's actually the same age as me, 21, except I'm a day older than him, May 10th, May 11th. A little redundant, but you know what?
Torches.
It's kind of funny. Right. So yeah.
So Stanley, what questions did you have for us today?
First off, before I ask, I just want to give a shout out to my mother because today's her birthday. So, Mom, happy birthday, and I love you. And also, I have been a huge fan of Cesaro for so many years, even way before he got to the WWE when he was Claudio Castagnoli in Ring of Honor. And I think it's obvious to see that he's been getting a huge push lately with him winning the Andre the Giant Battle Royal at WrestleMania, and he's in this Intercontinental Championship tournament. But
and he's aligned with Paul Heyman now.
Yes, which is a very, very good move. And I feel as if, and I say this as a Cesaro fan / Claudio Castagnoli, I feel like he's better suited to be placed in a feud with Daniel Bryan over the WWE world title that Bryan just won days ago at WrestleMania. And so my question was, do you guys agree with the fact that instead of having Mr. Cesaro compete in this tournament, do you guys feel as if it would be better if he was placed in a
title feud with Daniel Bryan?
Yeah. Hmm. Do you guys see that down the road?
Well, down the road I see that happening. Not at Extreme Rules.
Yeah.
I'd say maybe a
maybe around SummerSlam.
Well, probably before SummerSlam.
Oh, so maybe like Money in the Bank or something?
Around Money in the Bank, because I mean, I think it's a little too soon for him to be challenging. I think they still need a little time for it doesn't need to necessarily be a slow burn, mm-hmm. but it needs to be something that they build up to.
Right.
Like maybe let him hold the Intercontinental Championship if he actually goes to the finals against Big E Langston.
Mm-hmm.
Let him win it. Let him like hold it for a couple of months. Like have a really dominant reign. Like take on all comers. Turn back every opponent that comes his way, and then hopefully once he drops the title, we see that he's ready for a feud with Bryan, because we've seen a couple of matches with Bryan and Cesaro, and we know they could put on a great match.
Oh, yeah.
Not just in WWE, but also in Ring of Honor.
All right, so What's your second question?
Oh yeah, my second question was in TNA or Impact Wrestling, whatever the hell they call it.
Either or.
Yeah, but yeah. With Eric Young shocking the world, winning the TNA World Title for Magnus, I think it was 1 or 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, finally dethroning the freaking paper champion. Thank you, God.
Yeah, you know, there's a lot of fans, and I pretty much believe them when they say this title reign and this win by Eric Young winning the world title, a lot of fans see it as TNA ripping off, you know, Daniel Bryan winning the WWE title, because I guess the both of them, they both obviously they have beards and they're both labeled as the underdogs who came from nothing and fought and scrapped right to the top. And do you guys feel the same way?
Well, I mean, from a purely topical, superficial standpoint, there's obviously a lot of comparisons.
Yeah.
But I mean, you have to look at Magnus's reign. It was, they were looking for more and more ridiculous ways to have Magnus retain, and even just classifying him as a paper champion.
Yeah, which he really was.
Got ridiculous to a certain point. It went even beyond that. So, to answer your question, I'm happy for Eric Young.
Absolutely.
I am too, but I feel as if it basically happened at the wrong time, because this is coming off Daniel Bryan winning the title.
It's true. I mean, the timing could have been better.
Yeah.
I think it could have been better. But the fact is, they were looking to go in a different direction. I mean, they were running out of ways for Magnus to retain his championship, and to keep it from being beyond ridiculous means of him keeping his championship. I think they essentially realizing he wasn't getting over as a paper champion. It wasn't working. The storyline wasn't working. They had to go in a different direction, and they went for the twist. They went with. And I'll admit, it was similar. Just the both men wrestling two matches, both men wrestling under strain with an injury, both men going up against insurmountable odds and winning the World Heavyweight Championship. Mm-hmm. But okay, I think it's a great moment for Young. I don't think we should scrutinize so much about whether it was a ripoff of Daniel Bryan or not. Young's had his moment in the sun, and I just want to see where it goes before we start making more and more comparisons between him and Bryan.
Well, all I'm going to say, though, is, like, at least it's not, like, one particular guy, the show-off. Could have been something like that, but you know what, though? Thank God it wasn't. So, yeah, just for all you people out there, yes, I just did that. I don't care. Recognize, baby.
So Stanley, we want Stanley. We want to thank you for thank you for coming on.
Thank you, sir. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, many,
that one
many,
too.
Many
of course, right. Mine is awesome.
All right. So to close out this week's show, we go into preview for next week's segment. We're going to continue coverage of the Shield versus Evolution.
Mm-hmm.
Is the Shield going to get their payback on Triple H, Batista, and Orton,
mm-hmm.
and the people who, and of course the 11 men who laid them out?
Yep.
I mean, will Bray have more mind games in store for Cena or vice versa?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, who will come out on top in the Intercontinental Title Championship Tournament? Who's going to challenge Big E Langston at Extreme Rules? There are a lot of questions to answer, and mm-hmm. and I'm sure we'll have those answers next week.
Yep.
But for now, ladies and gentlemen, we sign off on another exhilarating episode of the Wrestling Connection.
Mm-hmm.
If you'd like to keep informed on all the happenings in the wrestling world, you can follow us at our Facebook page, The Wrestling Connection, on www.facebook.com/The Wrestling Connection.
Mm-hmm.
Or you could follow our official Twitter page at WKENNECTION at W Connection. Again, and we accept all we accept all questions from all walks of professional wrestling, from WWE, TNA, our Ring of Honor, New Japan Pro Wrestling.
The works.
Any wrestling question you have, we will answer.
Yep. So.
So for now, ladies and gentlemen, I am Ken Hill. He is Zach Martinkus.
Recognize.
We are the Wrestling Connection. Stay connected.